Curious Kids is a co-production of WGCU and the Golisano Children's Museum of Naples. Support is provided by the Florida Gulf Coast University College of Education.
I'm Sophie.
I'm Clint.
I'm Jaden.
I'm Jamie.
I'm Nicole. Welcome to the Treehouse.
2013 marked the 500th anniversary of Spanish explorer Ponce de León's first landing on the east coast of Florida.
He named our beautiful state Pascua, Florida, which means flowery land in Spanish.
The plants and flowers inspired him when he arrived in 1513, Florida, Easter time.
Lots of things we enjoy today are the legacy of those first European settlers and of the Calusa Indians, who arrived more than 11,000 years earlier.
It's not just humans who have adapted. Plants and animals, the water, and the land have changed.
Did you know that much of Southwest Florida used to be ocean?
And if you know where to look, there are plenty of clues that tell the story.
So, of course, we were curious.
Right! Where better to start than by meeting someone who spends his time exploring the past?
Mark Rentz is a paleontologist. That means he studies prehistoric life and fossils. We found him on the banks of a small creek that flows into the Peace River. Not exactly where you'd imagine finding prehistoric sharks.
It's kind of hard to envision this as an environment once inhabited by ancient sharks, let alone sharks that might have been the size of two school buses.
Whoa, can you imagine that?
And if you picture 2 or 3 million years ago where we're sitting, was not a cow pasture. We'd be in about 20 feet of an ocean bay with creatures like this swimming over us. And the adult megalodon shark would be about 60 feet long and would have teeth anywhere from 4 to 6 inches in size.
This one looks more dangerous than this one. It's more pointy.
Yeah, it does, doesn't it? Well, what happens to a perfect shark's tooth after it falls out of the jaw and tumbles for a million years? It doesn't look as the same, does it?
Wow, this is a shark's tooth?
Yes.
This is so cool. I would just mistaken it for a rock. So it gets like smoothed out from all the waves and everything.
From the sand and the water and the tumbling. That's why at Venice Beach, when we were talking earlier, you find more shark's teeth that are worn. They get tumbled in the surf. And then on the whale side, oops.
That's huge. Is that a tooth?
That's a tooth. That's a whale tooth. Probably from a 35, 40 foot toothed whale.
Turns out it wasn't only sharks and whales roaming around here a long time ago. When Florida wasn't underwater, it was home to people and to pretty big animals like mammoths.
So when we're out, we don't always find complete mammoth and mastodon teeth. We find fragments of them. So what we find more often, instead of the complete tooth of a mammoth or a mastodon, and this is mastodon, are pieces of the tooth. And can you match that, where that might fit in?
Looks like one of the sides of them.
Correct, one of the cusps.
Time to go and try our luck at finding some fossils in the river. Mr. Mark seemed to think we'd find something. Dig, 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 and sift, sift, sift. Are we ever going to find anything? We soon learn that there's a lot of detective work and patience we need when digging for clues about the past. So what if we find something? Can we keep it?
In state-owned rivers like the Peace River, you have to have a permit to even collect these fossils. And then you're required to report to the state what you find annually, no matter what it is.
What's the biggest thing you found here?
Mammoth teeth. Mammoth elephant teeth.
Wow.
About the size of my head and maybe then some.
I found gold! Well, black gold.
We may not have found gold, but we did find some teeth.
Tooth from the upper jaw of a gray shark. She has a lemon shark tooth, and then back to Cody again with a tiger shark tooth, and a stingray grinding plate from the jaw.
And let's not forget my alligator tooth.
What can we learn from the past?
One of the things I have learned is that extinctions happen, and they happen rapidly. In fact, something like 95% of every life form ever to live on Earth is now extinct. So I want to know what came before me so I have a better idea of what may happen after.
So this is Lake Annie, and I thought it would be a really great place for us to come because there's some special history stories I can tell you about Lake Annie, and it helps us think about the whole of South Florida and the whole of what's happened here.
Lake Annie is part of the Archbold Biological Research Station's property, located up on Lake Wells Ridge, about an hour north of Punta Gorda. Earlier in the day, Dr. Swain and members of her team took us out to explore the unique Florida scrub habitat that surrounds the lake.
Lots of the bushes around here are actually oak trees. And every year, they produce tons of acorns. So that's what the scrub days come and get. They get the acorns and they bury them in the sand. And every year, every scrub day buries between about 7,000 acorns.
Being a detective out here can lead you to some pretty cool discoveries, like this plant called the saw palmetto. Not only does it manage to survive wildfires, but it turns out it may have been alive longer than anyone has ever proven.
After a burn, you can sort of see all the long stems that grow along the ground. They almost look like a long alligator back. And that made us think of Archbold years ago. I wonder, how old are these things?
Dr. Abramson, a visiting scientist, asked the same question 40 years ago, so he began measuring the stems.
And every year he came back and he said, how much longer is that stem than it was the year before? And they were just growing a really small amount every year.
So this saw palmetto has been growing 1.2 centimeters a year. We're going to use the measuring tape to measure back until it disappears under the sand back there and see how long it's been growing right here.
We measured 230 centimeters, just a little bit of the stem that we could see. Divide that by 1.2 and you get...
So that's 191 years from here going all the way back to there. And notice it doesn't stop there, right? It continues. We just stopped measuring it because we lost a little bit of it underground.
That didn't seem so old, but Dr. Abramson continued to measure the stems for 40 years and he just published his findings. Can you guess how old he found the plants to be?
His average age was somewhere in the 5,000 year old.
Wow.
And the oldest individual was somewhere between 8 and 10,000 years old. Can you imagine? This plant could be here for thousands of years.
Back at Lake Annie, Dr. Swain told us how researchers use special instruments to drill deep down in the sediment. They pull up big tube-like samples of material called a core. A core contains particles of pollen, algae, charcoal, and other things that have been buried in the lake.
We have a 38-foot core from the bottom of this lake. We've got several cores, and one of them goes back more than 40,000 years. So can you imagine? It's like having a diary or a calendar of Lake Annie going back nearly 40,000 years. And we can tell when it was a little bit wetter and cooler here. Like the last 7,000 years, we've had a lot more pine trees and a lot more grasses because we can see that in the pollen.
Palmettos, tiny wasps, scrub jays, and layers of pollen. This was a cool lesson way back in time. I wonder if kids in the future will find some of the same amazing plants and animals that we did today.
We're living to the rhythm of this precious land. From the river of grass to the golden sands. Out to the Gulf of Mexico. And down through the sloughs where the alligators roam. Swallowtail cats and eagles fly, and clouds like mountains climb the summer skies. People they come and people they go, but the land's connected by the water's flow. Flow, flow, rhythm and flow, we're all connected by the water's flow.
Flow, flow, rhythm and flow,
the story of the land's in the water's flow.
Flow, flow,
Discovery Center at the Conservancy of Southwest Florida is a great place to learn about nature. There are all kinds of cool exhibits to see there, like an alligator pond complete with little hatchlings. That's where we found Conservancy wildlife biologist Ian Bartizek, who studies alligators in the wild.
And look how this little water dragon is just right there at the water surface. This is an example of maybe summertime high water environment out in the swamp. And all of these animals, the turtles, some of these native fish here, they could all be found with the alligator in their environment.
How long can an alligator stay underwater?
Good question. Normal dives of alligators may last 15 minutes to 30 minutes, but sometimes they can stay under for up to 2 hours. When the water temperature is much colder, they can stay underwater a lot longer. They're remarkably adapted for this kind of aquatic environment, and they hunt right here at this water level in the interface there with the land. That little hatchling there that has his head up on the rocks, when they're young, they mostly like to eat invertebrates, snails, and insects.
Adult alligators feed on fish, turtles, birds, and other mammals. Do not feed alligators because it makes them approach humans, and that can be dangerous.
If you see an alligator in the wild, don't panic. But if you see a hatchling in the wild, one of the next questions you should ask yourself is, where's mama? Because the mother alligator stays around the hatchlings for a very long period of time, and she's very attentive, and the hatchling alligators can give a distress call, and it will bring the mother right to their side. Would you guys like to go learn more about alligators and meet our naturalist Whitney?
Yes.
Let's go.
Miss Whitney was waiting for us in the Conservancy's learning lab. She had a live baby alligator for us to look at.
All right, pretty cool, huh?
Yeah.
All right, take a good close look at him. All right, you guys notice anything? They actually have two eyelids. You see that?
Oh.
Do it again. So he has one that goes from the bottom to the top that closes like ours. And then he also has what's called a nictitating membrane. It goes from the front to the back, and those serve as goggles. So whenever they're underwater, they have that membrane that they can still see through.
Why are alligators so important to the landscape here in Florida?
When they get very large and in charge, these powerful jaws and these powerful tails, they're able to modify the environment. They can move vegetation around, wallow around in low spots, and create these water holes known as gator holes in the landscape. Those holes will hold water throughout the dry season of South Florida. And then many species of invertebrates and fish and amphibians will benefit by that oasis in the wetland environment. So they're what we refer to as an ecological engineer.
Have you ever wondered what those pointy scales are on an alligator's back? They're called osteoderms, and they act kind of like mini solar panels.
Alligators are reptiles, and therefore they're cold-blooded, so they rely on their environment to help regulate their body temperature, and these osteoderms help them do that.
What's this?
This is a fossil crocodilian from Florida that went extinct over 5 million years ago. And this crocodilian got over 33 feet in length.
Yikes, that's big! It's rare to find alligators that grow to be more than 15 feet these days. The term crocodilian includes alligators, gharials, and the American crocodile. So much more to learn about these incredible creatures and how they shape our Florida landscape. Stop by the Conservancy if you're in Naples. It's really cool to watch them safely up close. They really are like little water dragons.
For thousands of years, the Colusa Indians lived here in Southwest Florida. Have you ever visited one of their shell mounds? The Colusa shell mounds, called middens, were made from layers and layers of shells that the people harvested for food. They ate a lot of seafood. But did you know that they were also incredible engineers? They built complex canal systems that allowed them to travel and transport their goods for long distances. You can climb a Colusa shell mound in lots of coastal areas, like the Colusa Heritage Trail on Pine Island or at Mound Key State Park in Fort Myers. I bet the Colusa kids were probably curious about a lot of things, just like we are.
Spanish explorer Ponce de Leon first discovered Florida in 1513, but it wasn't until 1521, when he was rumored to have been searching for the legendary Fountain of Youth, that he landed somewhere between Estero Bay and Charlotte Harbor. In 2013, Floridians celebrated the 500th anniversary of this historic landing with all kinds of festivities. The curious kids joined in on the fun when they visited the Punta Gorda Festival to watch a group of local citizens called the Royal Order of Ponce de Leon stage a reenactment of this historic landing.
There were plenty of flags flying to welcome everyone to the festival, including the early Spanish flag flying alongside the state of Florida flag.
Ponce de Leon was everywhere. Well, his statue, that is. There were even a few conquistadors manning the ships.
We had fun checking out some of the booths, and there were all kinds, from fossils to hats to masks and, yes, helmets and swords. But finally, it was time to go and welcome the conquistadors. Here they come.
They were throwing beads to everyone in the crowd as they passed by. Oh, Michael caught some.
They sailed around into the harbor, firing some cannon shots on the way. Watching them come ashore, I thought about how different it must have been sailing 500 years ago. No dock like this one.
Led by a priest, these modern-day conquistadors came ashore and slowly paraded through the crowds. Back in 1521, the Colusa Indians would have been the only inhabitants of this region. Back then, coastal forests grew closer to the water's edge.
Did Ponce de Leon really join Columbus to search for the New World?
Yes, I did. I went on one of his third journeys, and I was so excited about searching for the New World, that's why I formed my own flotilla, and that's why I made my own trip later on.
Do you think your costume is comfortable, or would you prefer today's clothing?
You know, this is very comfortable, but I really enjoy wearing shorts and flip-flops.
What do the feathers mean in your hat?
Ah, that's a great question. Number one, I am the only one, the Ponce in our organization, that wears a gold helmet. I am also the only one that has a gold feather. The red feather means that I'm a member. The blue feather means that I'm a member of the board.
A lot has changed since 1521. I wonder what the conquistadors would think if they landed on these shores today. The Atatiki Museum is on the Big Cypress Seminole Indian Reservation in southern Florida. It's a great place to learn about the Seminole people, their history, and culture. There are over 30,000 unique artifacts on display there. Miss Joy, the museum educator, was waiting to give us a tour.
Chehun Tamo, that means hello and welcome. And to the Atatiki Museum, the Museum of the Seminole Tribe of Florida. Would you like to go inside?
Sure.
The Seminole were not originally a single tribe, but an alliance of different tribes that migrated to Southwest Florida from parts of Georgia, Alabama, and Mississippi in the early 1800s. They traditionally lived by hunting and fishing, and much of their everyday life was spent gathering and preparing food.
Only women cooked, and as you can see, it represents three generations. So she's sitting down because she is the elder. This is the mother, so she'd be the second generation, and she's doing most of the work.
This young girl is about my age. No school for her. She's learning how to prepare the dishes she will have to cook for her family when she's older.
Are these the canoes they would go out in the Everglades with?
It is. And as you can see, this is a very long canoe. There are a lot of things in this canoe. The whole family is in this one. And it's because they're probably going to a trading post. And they would be gone for sometimes a week or two, so the whole family would go.
Time to go outside and explore some more.
Was the swamp important to the Seminole people?
The swamp is very important to the Seminole people. Lots of food and vegetation is found in the swamp. Different animals that they eat are found out here, things like alligators.
How did they manage to live out here in the heat and all?
Well, Seminoles live in something that's called a chiqui. It's a little open air kind of hut type, and it has a thatch roof made from the palm fronds, and they do a lot under there, and that keeps them cool throughout the day.
What about all the mosquitoes?
Well, the mosquitoes do bother them, but they have the heat from that fire, and the smoke actually detracts mosquitoes.
In the center of the Cypress Swamp is an example of a living village. Each chiqui hut has a specific purpose. This one's the cooking chiqui. It really does stay cool in there. Some of the Seminole artisans work at their crafts here. I love these beautiful bead necklaces being made by Miss Sally.
This is a very elaborate skill. It takes a lot of work and a lot of technical ability. Some of the beads, like those right here, are in traditional colors, things that are important to the Seminoles. For example, this is a medicine color.
Amazing how resourceful the Seminole people are. They learned to live in what must have been and still is a challenging environment. No mosquito control in those days, and definitely no air conditioning.
Aaliyah, Andrew, and Aisha went for a visit to the Collier County Museum to learn more about Southwest Florida's history. This sloth skeleton that greets visitors roamed Florida thousands of years ago. Looks kind of scary, doesn't it? Or maybe these guys are scarier. There are a lot of cool exhibits, some that map out Florida's ancient past, and ones on the Seminole Wars and pioneer life, too. Life was not easy for people living here. Just 100 years ago, there weren't any roads, so even if you had a car, which few people did, you couldn't just drive it around. The Tamiami Trail, also called US 41, took about 13 years to build and was finally finished in 1928. Did you know that the name Tamiami Trail came from combining the names of the cities on either end of it, Tampa and Miami? This little cottage was built in the early 20th century. It doesn't look so different from houses today, does it? Let's take a look inside. Check out the old stove, a little different from the one in my house. Oh, Aaliyah's found somewhere to take a nap. Okay, what's this they found? It's a sugarcane press. Sugarcane is a kind of grass with a high sugar content. That's where most of our sugar comes from. Sugarcane was brought to the American South in the 1700s. It's been grown commercially in Florida since the 1920s. The stalks of the plant were fed into a press like this one. It extracted the juice, which was boiled down to thick syrup. Something sweet can take a lot of hard work. The Seminole War Fort is a replica of the ones built by the U.S. Army during the Second Seminole War in the 1800s. There were about four forts built in the Collier County. Cannons like this one were used to fend off the enemy, and lookout towers, sometimes called cupolas, let the soldiers check out the approaching enemies. Fast forward to the early 1900s. That's when the steam locomotive, called the Deuce, was built. It was used to carry logging crews deep into the Fakahatchee and big cypress swamps. Much of Southwest Florida was once home to large forests of pine and cypress trees. You can kind of get a feel for what it must have been like long ago if you visited Big Cypress National Preserve. History is alive there, though it's one of the last stands of old-growth bald cypress trees in the world. Standing among those old trees, you can almost hear the echoes of the past calling out to you.
500 years ago, European settlers brought over many of the plants that are still grown in Florida today.
Yeah, did you know Spanish explorer Ponce de Leon planted the first citrus trees near St. Augustine?
These days, nearly 300 different types of fruits and vegetables are grown on farms in the Sunshine State, then shipped off to different produce markets around the country, just like this one at Camont.
We thought it'd be cool to visit a big farm, so we went out to Lippman Farms in Lee County.
Ready, set, go! This is a big farm, over 5,000 acres. We were curious to see where some of the food we eat grows. Let's go meet Mr. Scott. He's the farm manager.
Hi, Mr. Scott.
Good morning. How are y'all doing?
Good. So what grows here?
These are eggplant. And if you notice, there's many different size eggplant here.
Why are they all different sizes?
Well, that's a great question. And what that is a matter of age. This eggplant, the small one, will be this big in a week. Then it'll take another week to get that big. And then it will finally be ready here. This eggplant here would be considered the perfect size for your parents to take home. This would be used more in the food service industry and the restaurants when they're serving sliced eggplant.
Looks like a lot of the eggplants were ready to go to market.
Next up, tractor ride. Mr. Scott was taking us for a ride. I've always wanted to ride a tractor. It was cool.
This tractor was pretty powerful, and those blades were able to move a lot of soil fast. Back in the day, it would have taken a lot longer to plow a field like this one. You'd have needed a steam engine or help from four-legged friends.
Now we're in a zucchini field, also known as green squash. You can see the zucchini that are growing here. You see this big one?
Yeah.
He's going to be harvested today. This particular crop, we use bees to do the pollination. Bees are a very important part of farmers and how we produce our crops. The bee will go to the male flower, he'll feed, get the pollen attached to him. You see all the pollen on my finger right there? Mm-hmm. And then when he goes to feed into the female flower, he completes the pollination cycle.
What would happen if there were no bees?
No bees, no food. It's pretty much that simple. If this flower did not get pollinated by a bee, it would slowly die and rot.
Are there any other animals who help pollinate?
There are, but bees are definitely the most important.
Florida is famous for its oranges, so we had to go and see the orange groves.
You know how many times a year you pick oranges? One. One crop a year, that's all we get off these orange trees.
Why are some oranges green and some orange?
Well, this particular variety of orange will actually be harvested in November, and it doesn't get really bright orange like the oranges you would see in the store. This orange is simply for juice, but if I cut it, you can see all the juice coming out.
See
how pretty it is on the inside?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Where do the oranges go to get juiced?
They stay in the state of Florida. These oranges will be juiced here in Florida and will be on your grocery stores very soon.
Orange juice from Florida. How cool is that?
Agriculture is a big part of Florida's history, and it lives on with farms like Lippman. Can you believe Native Americans first started growing corn, squash, cucumbers, and beans in Florida more than 1,000 years ago? Thanks to all the people who provide us with food. Oh, and let's not forget the bees. Exploring state parks is a fun and great way to get some exercise.
Correction State Historic Site is in Estero. It was originally home to the Corrections, a community of early pioneers who came to Southwest Florida in 1894.
Some of us curious kids had fun exploring the park, then got to eat some delicious food that could have been served up by the Corrections.
There's lots of wildlife to be found in state parks. Correction Park is on Estero River, so you might get to see river otters, alligators, or even a manatee in the winter months.
If you hike the trails, you could catch a glimpse of a bobcat, gray foxes, or raccoons. The park is also home to over 100 species of birds.
What about going on a canoe or a kayak? There's a launching pad right there on the Estero River. Looks like Sierra and Jaden are having fun.
Have you ever tried fishing? There are several places you can fish from in the park. There are all kinds of fish in the Estero River, like snook, mullet, and redfish. We didn't catch anything. Maybe next time.
I love camping. You can camp out at Correction Park. Looks like the kids have found their special spot. Tents always seem to take a little bit of figuring out, but once they're up, it's home away from home.
And when you're finished doing everything else, this park's even got a playground.
And we had time for a little dancing.
All that exploring made us pretty hungry.
Mr. Stan Malecki volunteers his time to bake bread at Correction State Park during the winter months. That's where we found him baking up a fresh batch of bread Correction style.
He made that the Corrections would have made, and we're going to pull that out of there and put it down here. The reason that I use the pans is because that's what the Correction bakers used when they were in the bakery, okay? And this is about the size of a loaf, and that's the recipe. All right, we're going to cut some loaf, some bread up here for you. The Corrections would bake 200 loaves of bread sometimes in one day. They'd get up very early in the morning, 4:30, and start their baking. And people would find out about that, and they would come here. The Seminole Indians would come here. And the reason that they did was because they had never tasted bread that had yeast in it. I'm going to pass this around. The butter's down there. You can pass that around, and you can taste it. Take a piece of bread. And I'm going to tell you what's in this bread. They used flour, salt, yeast, water, and a little bit of milk.
That bread tasted really good. The historic Correction Bakery was built in 1903. Most visitors to the park aren't allowed to go inside the actual bakery. Luckily, Mr. Stan has permission, so we got to check it out. It was kind of like being in a time warp to see everything laid out just the way it was over 100 years ago.
Just in case we were still hungry, Mr. Stan baked some more bread for us, and volunteer park ranger Miss Petey had cooked up some sweet potato soup, another favorite Correction recipe. It was a tasty feast from another time.
A well-balanced body starts with well-balanced foods, and being careful about what goes on your plate is worth the wait. The USDA recommends the healthy plate, incorporating proteins, grains, dairies, fruits, and vegetables. Notice these foods don't come out of a box or a can. These wholesome foods were made fresh so that they maintain all those key nutrients that your body needs as fuel. So next time you select foods for your plate, a balanced proportion will keep your body in motion.
That bread was so good.
I know, and the Correctionists used to make hundreds of loaves a day.
You guys sure had fun in the park.
I never knew alligators could help shape the land. That's pretty cool.
What about saw palmettos that go back thousands of years? Imagine what they've seen.
We can learn a lot from the past, and that can help us create a better future.
Yeah, how about protecting the water and the land? That way, kids in the future can explore and have fun here like we have.
We're all connected by the water's flow.
Right.
Flow, flow, rhythm and flow. See you next time.
Stop by asking how and why.
How and
watch
why?
The birds, how do they fly?